Thank you. Well, good morning. On behalf of the Williams family, I thank each of you. Well, most of you are the Williams family. I just thank you all for being here today and honoring George in this way. For all those that are probably live streaming or hearing us today via any type of other device, know that your presence is felt and known here. I was thinking about this on the way over here this morning, you know. At the end of the Gospel of John, the writer says that he supposes that all the books in the world couldn't contain all the words that took place regarding Jesus' life. And I find the same is true when we sit and think about each of our lives too. What we do today and who is gathered here today is in no way, shape, or form a witness to the impact that George has had on so many lives. We couldn't possibly tell his story in one day. We couldn't possibly relive all that he has done. And any of you who know George know that stories are important. And so I invite you to be at peace here, to recognize that we're here to celebrate a life well lived, and that we are going to do so with tears and laughter, and that the family would invite you, as all that I've talked to just be at this in this place at peace. It is different than you may remember coming into a church building. Things look different and feel different. We're wearing masks, we're seated here, separated by pews and distanced apart from each other. So I invite you to remember those things, to leave masks on during this service and to stay with your family group and to do all that we can during these weird times that make it difficult to do things the way we've always done. But yet we can still adapt and honor and live that story to the best of our abilities. So thank you all for your understanding. And for your commitment to helping us do those things so that we can honor George today inside and do so safely. With that said, there are several places each of you have a bulletin. I will invite you to read along where it says all in your head. One of the restrictions that they've asked us to do is no singing and no like reciting back and forth. And so as I read, just read with me silently or whisper under your mask if you must. But participate as wherever you can. It is our goal to allow everybody to participate in this service in numerous ways so that we can stand with George in this process as well. The Lord be with you. Yes. Okay, so this time we're practicing here. So in your head, use your inside voice. It's okay, we're learning. And so I will read both parts to make it easier for everybody to feel. Even in the shadows of death, God is with us. Praise to you, O God. Christ our Lord will never leave us nor forsake us. Praise be to you, O God. Hear these words of grace. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and I am the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet shall they live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. I died, and behold, I am alive forevermore, and I hold the keys of hell and death. Because I live, you shall live also. Dying, Christ destroys our death. Rising, Christ restores our life. Christ will come again in glory. As in baptism, George put on Christ, so in Christ may we be clothed with glory. Here and now, dear friends, we are God's children. What we shall be has not yet been revealed, but we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Those who have this hope purify themselves, even as Christ is pure. Now I invite you to take a moment here to listen to the song. We've tried to prepare and have experienced small technical difficulties, but I would also, as you're getting ready back there to play this song, point out that these two TVs that are installed in this church very soon were one of the first projects that George picked up around here and thought was important for the church to maybe look more like a modern living room than grandma's front room. And so he wanted these TVs installed, and so I'm glad we're able to use them during this service to honor his organization and vision to making sure that we can enter the 20th century in the church. So I'll go ahead and invite you to play there. Go ahead.
Thank you.
I'll invite you to follow along with me as I recite our opening prayer for us. Almighty God, from whom we come and to whom our spirits return, you have been our dwelling place in all generations. You are our refuge and our strength, a very present help in trouble. Grant us your blessing in this hour, and enable us so to put our trust in you that our spirits may grow calm and our hearts be comforted. Lift our eyes beyond the shadows of earth, and help us to see the light of eternity. So may we find grace and strength for this and every time of need, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now, we are fortunate enough to have several members of the family who have offered to share and participate with us in the service, so I'll invite you to come up to the lectern side, speak into the mic. When you get up there, there's a stool if you need to, because I'm not sure of heights on those, so as you're listed in the bulletin, I invite you to come forward.
Son of Man must be delivered over the hands of sinners, be crucified on the third day, and raised again. Then they remembered his words. When they came back from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and to the others. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the others with them who told this to the apostles. But they did not believe the women because their words seemed to be like nonsense. Peter, however, got up and ran to the tomb. Bending over, he saw the strips of linen laying by themselves, and he went away, wondering to himself what had happened.
Thank you, Paul, for your excellent job.
My comments will be briefer than some of you may expect. Given if you know me well, you may expect one thing and know that it's now possible for me to be brief. I'm doing this partially because I know George would be looking at one of his many watches saying, hey, wrap this up, we got food to go eat soon. But George was born January 4th, 1930, as many of you know, and that's the date that kind of brings us all here together. And I always kind of start things with a place of context. Born in Toledo, Ohio, in the middle of the Great Depression, sandwiched between this great point of history and World War II. The world was very different than it is now, and in very many ways, very similar to the way it is now. It was a struggle during that time of famine and loss that George was born into, so many people unemployed, everything took different resource value, you wasted nothing, and many people who lived through that time period are affected by it their entire lives. You find mason jars and garages with every little nook and bolt and everything organized and kept, everything repurposed, everything. They were the original recycle, reduce, reuse generation. You didn't waste anything. They did it for a different context. They did it from a place of need. And it shaped how you looked at work and money and family and what was important. And these things shaped George's life as they did any born during that time. Now, George grew up his whole life in this area, whether around Oregon or East Toledo or just born in Toledo, he grew up here. And I'm told that he went to Jerusalem Elementary not far from here. He walked barefoot both ways up 6 feet in the snow. Everybody's heard it. And at some point he lived out on Cougnell Road, and Mrs. Schmidt was his second grade teacher. We didn't hear any other teachers. Mrs. Schmidt stood out because Mrs. Schmidt was also all of George's kids' second grade teacher. It tells you an insight to the person he was, how connected he was geographically to this area, to the people of this community. They were more than just people that were neighbors, they were extended family. Everywhere you would go, you would know that George could point out the house and tell you some story or detail that you might not have known. And if you were a grandkid, maybe we're not too concerned about hearing. He graduated from Maycumber High School, where he focused on trades and aeronautics. And George loved tinkering and working on things of all kinds. His daddy was an iron worker, after all. And after graduation, George enlisted in the Marines. He worked on a flight unit and repaired radios. I'm told George loved to fly, and due to technology developments, George served on something called the Night Fighter Unit. It was the first Marine air unit to fly at night. The reason for that was the invention of radar and the technology that allowed you to see without seeing. Can you imagine that? The first one to get on a plane so many thousand feet up in the air and fly into the darkness, relying only on technology in front of you on a little screen. And we're not talking about modern technology, we're talking about early technology. That flying into the darkness, that taking that risk, is embodiment of George. He was willing to be an early adapter, oftentimes adjusting to new tech and new things that were coming up and willing to try new things. But George was also very proud to be a Marine, and he always had a story to share about his time in the Corps. When George got out of the Corps, he went to work as an iron worker like his dad, and for a time, which gave him even more stories to share with people. He could point to buildings and bridges and tell stories about those, and if he didn't have a story about it, such as the Craig Street Bridge, he'd have a story about his father and what he had done. During this time, he would meet Janet. The story goes something like this. George ended up in a conversation with a woman, not Janet, who told him at some point to meet her at a laundromat or the dry cleaner. And he goes to the dry cleaner to meet this woman. No one knows who George is talking about at all. It reminded me of a time a girl gave me the number for time and temperature. And I tried to call her, thought, hey, look, I got this number, and the girl wasn't there. He's looking all over for this girl. But lucky for George, he walks in, and he shared this story very recent with me, so I'm quoting him near verbatim when I say this. He walks in, and he sees a beautiful woman in a white blouse and a very tight black skirt. He was very happy to meet her, and he was immediately smitten by her in many ways. He talked, and she agreed eventually to meet him for drinks some other time. She called him pretty quickly. But she was engaged at the time to be married. But she called everything off when she met George. I'm not sure exactly what he did or said, or maybe what was put into those drinks, but he had talked her into it somehow. And she decided that she wanted to be with George, so she called the whole thing off. We find out later that she was dating at the time her sister's brother-in-law. There were no hard feelings. George told me and repeated that both of them had very fine weddings and very fine marriages, and they were both very happy. So, and after a short time of dating, they eloped. You know, everybody's destination spot, Angola, Indiana, over Memorial Day weekend. And after they married, it becomes important to understand that George, and this kind of gives you an insight into who George is. When he married Janet, he also married Janet's sister, Nancy. And this was a time and a place, if you didn't know, Nancy was somebody with disability, mental retardation. As it might be, or fragile X, number of ways to say that, but I want to make sure I'm communicating to those of you here. But George was ahead of his time. You see, at that time and place, persons with those disabilities or abilities would oftentimes be put in group homes or put in asylums of sorts and separated, and they thought it was reasoned that it was better for them to be locked up essentially into a jail and drugged and used for all number of manner of medical testing at the time, but George wouldn't have any of that, neither would Janet. And so Nancy was a part of their house from the very beginning, and George and her became more like brother and sister than anything else. There was a lot of fun and tiffing back and forth like you might imagine, and they developed a strong bond throughout, and George didn't treat her like she was handicapped, but rather held her accountable for who she was and invited her to take responsibility and to be involved in the community and not hidden away. Just an insight into a mind in a time and place where that was rare. They would eventually have 5 children during this time, and he would somehow leave becoming an iron worker after he got out of the Corps and then becoming a firefighter. And here we would find that George now had experienced or participated in all 3 of his real loves, first family, second, the Corps and the Marines or country, but then also service for his neighbors, his fellow man, right? He honored that call as he sought to pick up his boots and his hat and do the one thing many of us don't do, run into fires when most try and run out, to keep people safe. When I met with the family, I learned of a dedicated and committed family man, one who not only cared for his own, but loved neighbors, risked his life regularly and protected them. And as a fireman, he would come home for Christmas, I'm told, or Easter in the morning, because you'd work overnight or at 24. And when he would get back from duty, the kids knew you were not supposed to go downstairs until Dad came home. I get that. You want to make sure that all things ready from Santa are right there. And of course, you know, George would have to worry about how he would explain to his kids that he had either hit or run over the Easter Bunny or Santa, and that maybe Christmas or Easter was canceled. George kept things simple and practical. Like many firemen, he worked second jobs, often working with or for family, doing carpentry, fencing, concrete, whatever. Practical in the sense that, yeah, we do family vacations, things are important, but there's also this idea, pool or a vacation, you know, and let the family decide. Let them be involved in those choices. Of course, you know the kids chose pool. It's vacation every day in your backyard, right? Of course, that also led to new son-in-laws sniffing around the daughters around the pool, Tom. I heard stories. Jeez, come on, you know, George. But George's family always came first. That included grandkids as well. George was always present and real with the family that he was forming relationships with. He would meet people where they were, as they were. He treated each person as a unique individual and held them accountable to his own brand of discipline as well. You can measure up. You know who I'm looking at right now, don't you, Casey? All right. When I talk to family, I know, and knowing this firsthand, it became clear to me George has at least two gifts. Many more, I'm sure, but if we simplify it here, he had a gift of telling stories and a gift, like I said, of meeting you where you are. That's a rare gift, to be able to talk to any person, to wear many hats, to talk to the mayor of a community or the homeless person on the side of the street, everywhere in between. George didn't see strangers, he just saw friends that hadn't heard his stories yet. People of George's generation, as I kind of alluded to earlier, often misunderstood with their stoic face of how to deal with problems and the disciplinary structure that they have, their work ethic. But even today, the struggle continues to understand the importance of monuments and flags and memorials. These things are important. And as Rich was remembering going to DC on a trip to see Dad at these memorials, to see him reliving his life, his generation, the commitment and values of his time and place, you begin to start to find a way to honor those things that may be confusing to us younger people. We may see just stones, we may see just a monument, but to people like George, these are people that he lived with. They were living history. And they were people that reminded him of what he fought, lived, and died for. And so the issues we face today are far more complicated than we would like to create the binaries that exist. It was a part of his culture. It was important to show respect. These weren't just symbols, they were things that were worth telling the story of. They stood for something more. They were embodiments of freedom, embodiments of family, faith, and country. And it reminded me of my first time meeting George around this issue. I'm a new pastor appointed to this church, and you know, you got everybody leaving and going out, and I feel this hand grab my arm. And it felt like some 6'5" man had just grabbed my arm in a vice grip. And he had no concern of how hard he was grabbing me or who I was talking to at the time. He had to get my attention. Something was important. He waited till my second Sunday, of course. So he gave me one Sunday. Grabs my hand, looks at me, and goes, "Come out here. You need to see something." And he grabs me, he pulls me out to our flagpole, and he shows me the tattered flag that needs to be replaced. Now, he didn't just come to me with a complaint. He came to me with a solution as well. "I'll buy the flag. Just tell me I can, and make sure it gets put up here." And I said, "Of course, I'll take care of that." So the flag was bought, and we took care of it. And since then, I see the priority, and I looked at our flag today. We need a new flag. Just saying. But it became an important thing. He told me how important it was to him to just do it right. George honored the commitments he made. He was a person of honor and commitment. He loved and honored family. He loved and cherished his wife. He loved and honored his country, served his neighbors, was a dedicated member of this church most of his life. He embodied the idea of God, family, and country. And even as he faced his mortality, he ran around at Gardens of St. Francis and became very quickly the mayor of the Gardens of St. Francis. The entire community there stood up and took notice of who George was. The nurses, the dietary staff, even the people at administration downstairs knew what was going on, knew George, and honored, respected the Williams family as special people. I know this because they pulled me aside and told me how special all of y'all are. Now, special has lots of definitions, but I think they meant it at the most positive level. But even as he faced this time, he made the best out of it. He took care of his friends and neighbors. He checked in on people to make sure that they were visited and that they received phone calls. He checked in and hung out with two priests frequently and a pastor. See, George needed extra help. But I also remember, not soon before he passed away, I went and visited with family and walked in and saw George, grinning ear to ear, all day, just facing death with a smile on his face. No doubt, I imagine, thinking about how good Janet was going to look in her heavenly white blouse and tight black skirt. I reminded as I close my thoughts here regarding George and how I believe that God reveals God's self to us through each one of us. We are created images of God. George, throughout his 90 plus years, embodied many things to many of us. But I think God was communicating some key important aspects about who we are and whose we are. You see, God meets us where we're at. He doesn't care who you are or what status you are. God meets us where he's at. And God meets us with story. He's always got a good story to share about what his love has done or who his love has saved. George embodied so much more. But as you move forward from this place, as you move forward in your journey, and as you come across and remember George, I invite you to remember his commitment to God, to family, to country, to honoring his word, to meeting people where they're at, regardless of who they are, and remembering the importance of a good story to connect friends, to form relationship, and to reveal love. Because sharing a story is giving of your time. And so if George ever shared a story with you, he was sharing himself with you. So don't stop telling the story. Don't stop talking about George, because George is with us in new ways. Instead, ask God to help you see with new eyes how George is still with us. And know that God loves you where you're at, no matter who you are. And that God's got a story for you of his love if you just reach out. I leave that with you in Christ's name. Amen. At this time, I'd like to invite those who would like to share anything to come forward. Chris has decided he would share some remarks. And so following Chris's remarks, or if there are any others who would like to stand or share, they're invited to come forward to the lectern following Chris's remarks.
Most importantly,
those hands are now getting a hold of his beautiful bride again. Those hands are getting a hug, his sister-in-law. And those hands are getting a hold of his firstborn once again. So, I have lots of great memories in myself of those hands. I remember coming in when I was probably about 7 or so, and I wanted to build a toolbox for my dad for Father's Day. It was a terrible toolbox. It looked great. Granted, they did a great job helping me out, but I don't think it was functional at all whatsoever. But, you know, and the best thing was because I had an idea. I had an idea of what I wanted it to look like. Of course, it was a very cartoonish toolbox, but Grandma helped me have that vision come to play. I remember those hands bringing home donuts after he had delivered papers in the mornings when we would come over to visit, and that was such a special time. I think every single one of us probably has stories about all those things that those hands have done. I think my time is probably about that, at least 5 minutes. So I'll make those open up for anybody else at this point. So Grandma, thank you for everything.
As I've said, and as Chris alluded, by the way, I don't know if I want to follow you either. Thank you. It's an amazing thing to imagine all the lives his hands have touched. And know that no matter what we face and what we're doing, that the stories that you carry with you, whether spoken or not, are here and present today. I invite you as we follow along here and our bulletin as it comes, I'd like to invite Melanie to come up. She's going to read a poem titled A Hero's Welcome. And if you look in your bulletin, I have created a copy of that so you can follow along or have it for yourself to hear and read. Thank you, Melanie.
Thank you. We pray to you for one another in our need and for all anywhere who mourn with us this day.
To those who doubt, give light. To those who are weak, strength. To all who have sinned, mercy. To all who sorrow, Lord, peace. Keep true in us the love with which we hold one another. In all our ways we trust you. And to you, with your church on earth and in heaven, we offer honor and glory now and forever. Receive George into the arms of your mercy. Raise George up with all your people and receive us here also and raise us into new life. Help us so to love and serve you in the world that we may enter into your joy in the world to come. Amen. Also, I invite you to follow along with our closing prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. As Mary gets ready to play, these songs that are throughout the day were all chosen by George. So I invite you to listen to How Great Thou Art. Before we dismiss, I'll give a couple of brief instructions for what's about to take place. We will be processing out from this space and out this side here, and we will gather there. As it was brought up, George is extremely proud of more than two things, but especially these two things: his service for our country in the Corps as a Marine, and his service as a firefighter for the community of Toledo, East Toledo, and beyond that region around this area. And so we continue our service of honoring George's life by turning that time over to those groups of individuals to honor him in the ways that they know how to honor him best. And so our service continues, does not end from this place, but continues from this space out into the outside. And so I will invite you to follow other further instructions from Larry as we conclude. But as we leave this space, I invite you to leave knowing God goes with us, and that if we want to honor and remember George in the best ways possible, we can do so by doing what he did, meeting others where they're at, sharing his story, and loving God, family, and country. honoring your word. I leave that with you. Amen. Larry.
It's the same as what we did for the money.
Excuse me.
Part, whereas George was instrumental in founding the Center of
February 1980, where he served as both secretary and president for over 25 years. He took an active role and great pride in honoring active and retired firefighters who have passed by attending many last alarm services. Now, therefore, I, Wade Capsicavage, mayor of the city of Toledo, hereby remember and honor the life of George H. Williams.
Thank you, Chief. Now we will hear from the record from Robert Colbert.
Thank you, Renzo. Before I do the record, I'd like to do what we call the bell ceremony for George. The bell has a long tradition in the history of our country and in the fire service in particular. The sound of the... Hold on, George. The sound of the bell can both be pleasant and disturbing. The bell became one of the first instruments to be used to sound an alarm of fire in the community. For many years, firefighters began and ended their tours of duty at the sounding of the bell. One of the signals of the bell in the fire service was the sounding of three taps on the bell to indicate a job was completed. So it is appropriate that we sound the bell three times in honor and memory of George for a job completed and well done. Lieutenant George H. Williams, born January 4th, 1930. Appointed to the Toledo Fire Department June 1st, 1956. At that time, he was given badge 406. His assignments during his career with the department were stations 2, 5, 6, 7, 12, 13, FPB. On July 21st, 1967, he was promoted to lieutenant. Retired June 1st, 1972. Died on September 15th, 2020. From the record.
Thank you, Robert. Before I read the last alarm, I'd like to read the definition of a firefighter. Could be the person next door, a person's person with the memory of a young child. They have never gotten over the excitement of engines, sirens, smoke, and danger. They are people like you and me with wants, worries, and unfulfilled dreams. Yet they stand taller than most of us. They put it on the line when the bell rings. A firefighter is once the most fortunate and the least fortunate person. They are people who save lives because they have seen too much death. They are gentle people because they have seen the awesome power of violence out of control. They respond to a child's laughter because their arms have held too many small bodies that will never laugh again. They are people who appreciate the simple pleasures of life. Hot coffee held in numb, unbending fingers. A warm bed for bone and muscle compelled beyond feeling. The camaraderie of the brave, the divine peace, and selfless service of a job well done. In the name of mankind. They do not wear buttons or wave flags or shout obscenities. When they march, it is to honor fallen comrades. They do not preach the brotherhood of mankind, they live it. The last alarm. Memory is a priceless heritage of the ages. It is the echoing of happy days, experiences and emotions, fond recollections, beautiful traditions, friendships and comradeships, of those whose hearts were true. Today we are standing in memory of our departed brother George, who will never return from his last alarm. Reason tells us he is dead. Memory tells us that we will be with him all the days of our lives. And our faith tells us that one day we too will meet with him again. In the midst of his earthly activities, George was called to his eternal rest. Obedient to this call, he laid down his task and with a fearless smile responded to the decree from the throne of eternal love. Within the blessed soil, his earthly remains will repose so that loved ones might visit there with fragrant flowers as tokens of affectionate remembrance. But the soul of our departed brother is on the wings of angels, bound for that far distant shore of eternal bliss, where Almighty God will hand him the priceless gift of eternal life. Each wind that sweeps back to us from those eternal shores will carry the admonishing words from our brother, who will seek to tell us that life is short and that time is fleeting. His voice, tinged with affection, will whisper that it is best for earthly joy that we honor our parents, hold as sacred the veneration of God, practice faithfulness in all things, engender generosity to our friends, neighbors, and the strangers within our gates. Help the less fortunate and fill their hearts with the kindness of tolerance and mercy. Be true to our God, our families, and our country. And in all the days of our lives, let our hearts be softened with fairness and justice. When we too respond to our last alarm, we shall find our departed brother waiting to lead us to our Heavenly Father, who rewards those who love truth, practice charity, honor, and chastity, and stand with justice. With deepest reverence, brothers and sisters, let us bow our heads for a moment and say a silent prayer for the repose of the soul of George and the soul of all those who will never return from their last alarm. May the soul and the souls of all the faithful be touched in the mercy of God rest in peace.
Harris. Please step forward. I ask that you go to your cars. If you're driving in a procession with us, if you're the driver, if you want to take my name, that represents the procession. We will be going past Fire Station 5 for the last alarm. So again, we're going to ask that you go to your cars.